The implantation is a process whereby the embryo attaches itself to the luminal surface of the endometrium, followed by migration via the luminal epithelium and invaded into the deep layer of the endometrium to become embedded into the deeper layer. While implantation is a process with a well-defined starting point, it is a gradual process which lasts for several weeks with no universal agreement on when the process is completed. Implantation often considered to be successful when there is ultrasonographic evidence of an intrauterine gestational sac. Implantation failure is considered to have occurred if there is a lack of ultrasonographic evidence of an intrauterine gestational sac. Implantation failure may occur very early on during the attachment or during migration stages, with the result that there is no objective evidence of a pregnancy. That is, if you do pregnancy test, it is negative. It may also occur later on following successful migration of the embryo when HCG produced by the embryo may be detected in the blood or urine, but the process becomes disrupted prior to the formation of intrauterine gestational sac. It is clinically referred to as biochemical pregnancy. In ERT, implantation is considered successful when intrauterine gestational sac detectable by ultrasonography usually about 3 weeks after oocyte retrieval or about 5 weeks of gestation. From the clinical point of view, the term implantation failure refers to two different types of situation. Those in whom there has never been evidence of implantation, that means no detectable HCG production, and in those who have evidence of implantation, that is detectable HCG production, but it did not proceed to beyond the formation of a gestational sac visible on ultrasonography. What is the definition? The recurrent implantation failure is only applicable to patients undergoing ART. Although there is no accepted formal definition for recurrent implantation failure, Orvito suggests that it is up to 3 failed in vitro fertilization embryo transfer cycles with good quality embryos transferred. Jainarogyu et al. Agree that it is after 3 unsuccessful cycles of IVF, specifically with 2 embryos of high quality. But the colon has Cohen has suggested a more complete working definition taking into account maternal age, number of embryo transfer, number of cycles completed. She defined RF as the failure of clinical pregnancy after 4 good quality embryo transfers with at least 3 fresh or frozen IVF cycles and in women under the age of 40 years. Incidence, if you take, due to variation in definitions for recurrent implantation failure and biochemical pregnancy, there is scarce data that accurately represents the incidence or prevalence. In spontaneous conception, it is estimated that 30% of pregnancies are lost before implantation and 10% clinical pregnancy losses. It is also important to note that spontaneous pregnancy is only achieved in around 30% of normal fertile couples on the first try. What are the risk factors for recurrent implantation failure? One is important is the maternal age. Maternal age plays a crucial role in the quality of the embryos that are used for IVF. As maternal age increases, so does the frequency of aneuploidy. Pregnancy rate have been found to be decreased as maternal age increases. Same way, BMI. Increased BMI has impact on implantation rate. In patient undergoing IVF, class 1, 2 and 3 patients, that is beyond BMI beyond 30 kg, had the implantation failure when compared with patients of normal weight. Once it increased beyond the normal BMI, the pregnancy rate drops dramatically. Next is smoking. Smoking has been shown to lead to a significantly increased risk of miscarriage for each pregnancy in compared with non-smoking patients undergoing ART. Cigarette toxins might play a role in disrupting corpus luteum formation and implantation of the embryo. Next is stress. Elevated levels of cortisol, also known as the stress hormone, lead to 2.7 times greater chance of miscarriage within the first 3 weeks after conception in comparison with women with low cortisol levels. Cortisol production in the body rises in response to psychological, immunological, and other stressors, suggesting that it serves as a marker of stress. What are the causes for recurrent implantation failure? The 3 things are important. One is the gamete, another one the uterine factors, And third one is the associate factors. In gamete and embryo factors, oocyte quality, sperm quality, or parental chromosomal anomalies can affect. In uterine factors, it may be congenital or acquired. Acquired conditions like submucous fibroids, intramural fibroids, endometrial polyps, intrauterine adhesions, or sometimes diseases like adenomyosis. In associated factors, hydrosalpingosis, immunological factors, thrombophilic conditions can affect the implantation. And we'll see each one separately. Oocyte quality. Compromised oocyte quality as a cause of RAF is often suspected when there is a poor response to ovarian stimulation with fewer number of oocytes retrieved, high proportion of immature oocyte, reduced fertilization rate, and low utilization rate, embryo utilization rate. When the above features are associated with low antral follicle counts, high FSH, and low anti-Müllerian hormone, it can be assumed that the underlying cause of RAF relates to poor oocyte quality. Age-related decline in oocyte quality is associated with increased chromosomal non-distinction, resulting in aneuploid embryos, decrease in mitochondrial membrane potential, and increase of mitochondrial DNA damage. There is evidence to suggest that aggressive ovarian stimulation protocols may lead to the production of poor quality oocytes and higher rate of fertilization failure. When it comes to sperm quality, poor quality spermatozoa may lead to the production of poor quality embryos. Conventional semen analysis parameters do not accurately reflect sperm quality. Genetic tests are more useful as genome and epigenome integrity is essential for fertilization, normal embryo development, and successful implantation. A recent meta-analysis suggests that sperm DNA damage has a modest impact on pregnancy rates following IVF treatment. There is increasing recent interest in the use of sperm DNA integrity testing in the evaluation of reproductive failure. DNA fragmentation may be associated with an increased risk of miscarriage, but its association with RAF has not yet been established. When it comes to parental chromosomal anomalies, individuals with balanced translocations produce gametes with chromosomal aberrations, which in turn result in reproductive failure, ranging from defective gametogenesis to recurrent spontaneous miscarriage. Couples with a history of repeated IVF failure had a 2.5% chance of carrying a balanced chromosomal translocation, which was higher than that of the control population. When it comes to the uterine factors, the main thing is the congenital anomalies. Congenital uterine anomalies may affect endometrial receptive tree manifested as either infertility or recurrent pregnancy loss. Uterine septae are associated with first and mid-trimester miscarriages, possibly infertility, also contribute to RAF. In acquired intracavitary lesions, a number of acquired intracavitary uterine pathologies include submucous fibroids, endometrial polyps, and intrauterine adhesions may contribute to RAF. The frequency of unrecognized intrauterine pathologies in patients with RAF varies between 25% to 50%. Submucous fibroids, if you take, submucosal and intramural fibroids that distort the endometrial cavity are associated with decreased pregnancy and implantation rates in women who attempt to conceive spontaneously or who are proceeding with IVF treatment. Hysteroscopic resection of submucous fibroids alone appear to double the cumulative clinical pregnancy rates. Intramural fibroids, some suggest an adverse effect of non-cavity distorting fibroids and implantation and pregnancy rates in women undergoing IVF with large fibroid, there is more than 4 centimeters, whereas others fail to demonstrate such an association. Women with intramural fibroids appears to have reduced implantation rates compared with women without intramural fibroid. That means whatever size may be, even if it is distorting or not distorting, it can affect the implantation rate. However, myomectomy did not appear to significantly increase the clinical pregnancy and live birth rates. When it comes to the endometrial polyps may interfere with embryo implantation. The removal of endometrial polyps has been found to result in improved spontaneous pregnancy rates. Recent systematic review found that hysteroscopic removal of endometrial polyps resulted in doubling of the clinical pregnancy rate in women undergoing IUI. It is likely that endometrial polyps contribute to RAF. comes to the intrauterine adhesion, the presence of adhesions within the uterine cavity may interfere with successful implantation at an early stage by preventing the embryos from attaching to the luminal surface of the endometrium. Intrauterine adhesions often occur following curettage of the gravid uterus after MTP or marriage. Intrauterine surgery or intrauterine infection may also lead to the formation of intrauterine adhesions. In India, we have to keep in mind about the tuberculosis infections. Intrauterine adhesions occurs in 8.5% of women with RIF. The evidence available so far suggests that hysteroscopic removal of intrauterine adhesions improves fertility outcomes. Another important factor is the adenomyosis. Literature evidence available to suggest that adenomyosis has an adverse effect on female fertility. Adenomyosis almost always affects the junctional zone of the uterus, which may have a greater impact on implantation than intramural fibroids. Surgical interventions in the case of adenomyosis is technically more challenging than fibroids. Excision of the adenomyosis often initiates removal of part of the uterine wall. It can lead to some problems. Next is another associated condition. If you see, hydrosalpingo is one of the important causes for RIF. The live birth rate of patients with hydrosalpingo undergoing IVF is only 50% that of women who do not have hydrosalpingo. In an RCT, women who had hydrosalpingo prior to IVF, the pregnancy rate was 23.9%, miscarriage rate was 26.3%, and live birth rate was only 16.3%. Whereas after salpingectomy, for this patient, the results improved to 36.6%, 16.2%, and 28.6% respectively. So there is good evidence that salpingectomy prior to IVF in women with hydrosalpingo improves outcome. What are the pathophysiological mechanisms of recurrent implantation failure? Immunological, infectious cause, or altered expression of associated molecules, anatomical abnormalities, and endometrial thickness, genetics. But take the immunological causes, natural killer cells, and peripheral, and also uterine endometrium. And there will be alteration in the TH1 and TH ratio, and TNF alpha levels, autoantibodies, antiphospholipid syndrome, hereditary thrombophilias. These are all things can affect the implantation. PLC each one separately. The immune system is a collection of cells, tissues, and molecules that protects the body from pathogenic microbes and toxins. It is divided into two parts, innate or natural immune response that is more aggressive and does not have memory. Whereas adaptive immune response, it is silent, but when gets activated, creates barrier to neutralize or eliminate foreign body or microbes. In adaptive immune response can be humoral. In humoral response, plasma cells, that beta cell, B cells, produce soluble antibodies like IgM, IgG, IgA, etc. Whereas in cell-mediated response is T lymphocytes and macrophages, which activation of cytokines. When it comes to natural killer cells are a section of the innate immune system and constitute 5 to 10% of the peripheral blood lymphocytes, 70 to 9% of uterine lymphocytes. There are two subgroups of human natural killer cells identified by cell surface density of CD56, that is CD56 bright or CD56 dim. Both peripheral natural killer cells and uterine natural killer cells show the surface CD56 is common for them. Peripheral natural killer cells differ from uterine natural killer cells in both phenotype and function, and the fact that 10% of peripheral natural killer cells are similar to uterine natural killer cells. 90% of peripheral natural killer cells are CD56 dim and CD16+, whereas 80% of uterine natural killer cells are CD56 bright and CD16 only. CD56 dim cells have more toxic activity, Whereas CD56 bright part is most important source of natural killer cell derived immunoregulatory cytokines. Uterine natural killer cells are important for the success and continuation of the pregnancy. To date, all studies are still investigative, and the role of natural killer cells in recurrent implantation failure and recurrent miscarriage is still controversial. Natural killer cell level and activity is just one aspect of the immune system involved in women suffering from infertility, and we need more data in order to yield clinical values from this information. Then when it comes to TH1 and TH2 ratio on TNF alpha levels, elevated levels of TH1 cells are associated with rejection of embryos, whereas elevated TH2 cell levels are associated with pregnancy. Cytokines produced by TH1 cells, such as TNF alpha, suppress trophoblastic growth and adversely affect implantation. Cytokines produced by TH2 cells, such as IL-14, interleukin-6, and IL-10, inhibit TH1 cell-induced stress factor by monocytes so that the pregnancy implantation rates will improve. Higher mean ratio of TNF alpha to IL-4 in fertile blood samples have been measured in women with multiple implantation failures, both with no history and history of spontaneous miscarriage, compared with mean ratios in control. Interesting to note that no bichemical pregnancies result in this sample population, indicating that bichemical pregnancy may have other pathophysiological mechanisms. When it comes to the antibodies, several autoimmune antibodies such as anti-nuclear antibodies, anti-cardiolipin antibodies, and antiphospholipid antibodies are involved in biochemical pregnancy loss. An increase in biochemical pregnancy in patients with these autoantibodies, as well as morphological changes in the embryos themselves, specifically in those women with ACAs. There is a direct interaction between anticardiolipin antibodies and the embryos prior to their implantation. Although the mechanism is still not well understood, there is a strong association between anti-beta-2-glycoprotein 1 and anti-nuclear antibodies and implantation failure. Beta-2-glycoprotein 1 is the cofactor for anticardiolipin, and 30% of patients with implantation failure tested positive for beta-2-glycoprotein 1 or antiphospholipid antibody, antiphosphatidyl ethanolamine, in comparison with 16% of fertile controls. It is important to understand that this is a strong association, but there is no evidence to suggest that these antibodies directly cause the implantation failure. Next comes to the antiphospholipid syndrome. Antiphospholipid syndrome and its definition might be important to consider in relation to RIF patients. To diagnose APS, one clinical and one laboratory criteria must be met. Studies have shown that the antibodies are present in RIF patients, but the specific clinical and laboratory criteria might not be met in RIF patients. There is accumulating evidence of non-criteria clinical and laboratory manifestations of APS, of which one criterion is two or more unexplained failed IVF cycles. A meta-analysis conducted by Hornstein et al. From 7 studies revealed no statistically significant association between presence of antiphospholipid antibodies and clinical pregnancy or live birth rates in future IVF cycles. Some studies have suggested that these women benefit from standard APS treatment, that is, Lodestrant, aspirin, and heparin. Due to presence of specific antibodies implicated in both APS and RIF, it is important to consider if RIF should be added to the clinical criteria for antiphospholipid syndrome. Next comes to hereditary thrombophilia. There is data suggesting hereditary thrombophilia may be involved in a subgroup of women with unexplained RIF. Azam et al. Found that there are higher rates of inherited thrombophilia such as methylene tetrahydrofolate reductase deficiency, factor 5 laden prothrombin deficiency, and antithrombin 3 deficiency in women with RIF in comparison with control, whereas 44% versus 18%. Though this needs to be confirmed by further studies, this could lead to the evaluation of antithrombotic agents as another potential intervention for women suffering from RAF. When it comes to infection, many women with RAF have chronic endometritis from characteristic colonization with a minimal or no clinical signs of infection. Kushner et al. Found that among a sample of infertile patients, 45% when they investigated, 45% had chronic endometritis, particularly those with RAF. Immunohistochemistry stain for SADENCAN-1, that is CD138, a plasma cell marker, can be used to provide a more accurate diagnosis, though agreement on the standard number of plasma cells present is not established. When you are sending the endometrium for histopathological examination, they won't give you. You have to specifically mention immunohistochemistry for CD138, then only they will do the one special staining. If the CD138 is positive, then only we can diagnose as chronic endometritis. Hysteroscopy had a 40% sensitivity for detection of chronic endometritis, visualizing mucosal edema, endometrial hyperemia, and the presence of micropolyps. Cicinelli et al. Found that 66% of women were diagnosed with chronic endometritis via hysteroscopy, 57.5% with histology, and 45% were also culture positive. RT-PCR showed 75% sensitivity and 100% specificity compared with the concordant results of other three tests. Pathogens commonly found are beta streptococcus, E. coli, and enterococcus faecalis, or sometimes you will come across mycoplasma in some Chlamydia can be also be responsible. What are the altered expression of associated molecules? One is hyperglycosylated HCG. Hyperglycosylated HCG is produced by cytotrophoblast cells and is thought to assist the embryo's invasion into the decidua during implantation. Concentrations of hyperglycosylated HCG in the urine and serum are significantly lower in women who had biochemical pregnancy in comparison with those with successful term outcomes. It is not clear whether low hyperglycosylated levels are a cause or effect of the implantation failure. More studies with larger samples needed to validate this data. Next is leukemia inhibitor factor. A part of the IL-6 family of cytokines is one of the factors that has been explored in relation to endometrial receptivity. Low levels of LIF have been associated with higher risk for implantation failure. Humbers women demonstrated that LIF production is decreased in women with RAF. Women with RAF had decreased LIF in the secretory phase of the menstrual cycle when compared with the proliferative phase. In contrast, there was no statistically significant difference in LIF levels between the two phases of the menstrual cycle in controls. In summary, you know, like the gametes and the uterine factor and the other factors like thrombophilia, cytosolving, other problems is important. We have to keep in mind when you're investigating. In conclusion, RAF should be defined as the failure to achieve a clinical pregnancy of transfer of at least 4 good quality embryos in a minimum of 3 fresh or frozen cycles in a woman under the age of 40 years. Women with RAF should be offered appropriate investigations to rule out an underlying cause for the repeated failure. The main treatment strategy in couples with RAF is to improve the quality of the embryos transferred and the receptivity of the endometrium. Hysteroscopy should be carried out to exclude any intracavity uterine pathology. It has been shown to improve outcome. Appropriate investigations should be carried out to exclude hydrosalping, as it has been shown to reduce implantation rate, increase miscarriage rate, and reduce live birth rate. Removal of hydrosalpinges has been shown to improve the outcome. Submucosal fibroids have been shown to reduce implantation, pregnancy, and live birth rates. Removal of submucosal fibroid improves implantation rate. Endometrial polyps should be removed. Although there is no data on its impact on women undergoing IVF, it has been shown to improve outcomes in women undergoing intrauterine insemination. uterine septum increases miscarriage rate, its removal improves outcome. The use of ultra-long protocol may improve outcomes in women with endometriosis and adenomyosis. Intrauterine additions are a recognized cause of thin endometrium not responding to ovarian steroid stimulation. If present, intrauterine additions should be removed. These are the references.